And I just jotted these things down on a serviette that Ron had, and that's what the money, whatever the incentives were or whatever, and then Ron just sort of cleaned it all up, and that's, I don't think he ever signed a contract, did he?
And the deal was done. And it was one of the best things I ever did.
It was really a handshake, and I think they did some notes on a serviette, and that was the contract.
Well, I've been missing football, the involvement of football over the past couple of months after having 10 months rest from it, and that's basically the reason to get back into football in an area which offers a lot in the way of fulfilment and satisfaction.
They said that they had fixed up Brassey. He was going to coach when they approached me.
It was getting towards the start of before they started their training, and I got a phone call at work one night from Ron saying, "What are you doing?" And in footy, and I said, "Oh, I'm not doing anything this year, I don't think." And he just said, "Will you come to North Melbourne with me? I'm at North now, and I'd like you to come across as my assistant." And so I said, "Yes, I will."
What about players? It was mentioned that you wouldn't take on the position unless North recruited a number of 10-year players.
No, this is definitely incorrect. It may well have been my thinking, or I may well have said that if their thoughts hadn't have been along these lines, but, you know, anybody with a grain of sense could see that in this position that they are in, that they have to have players.
We were chasing Barassi at the same time as we were chasing the 10-year rule players. And the great thing that, you know, I admired about Barassi being sort of right there in the middle of it was that he made a commitment to come to North Melbourne as coach only in the knowledge that we were trying to get Davis and Dittrich. Yeah. Rantel wasn't even on the scene in those that time. But he made a commitment to coach and sign with North to coach before Davis or Wade or any of those blokes were over the line.
Well, how high are you aiming?
Well, it's a bit of a tell yet. You know, it's stupid just saying I'm going to win a premiership. That's the aim, but it may take 3 or 4 years. You could do it in 1 year, perhaps, if you had the material. I haven't sized it up yet. I'd love to win a premiership, of course. But as far as it saying it's a definite aim, where I want to finish this year, I have to see the material here, and I haven't seen enough of it yet.
We just had a single mission to get Brass, and most of us were about the same age as Ron Brassey anyway, and we got to know him very, very well over our football careers, so we had a leg in the door, so as to speak, and Ron, being the person he is, always loves a challenge, and he accepted the challenge, and we were up and away.
He runs in now, North Melbourne, 3 points in front.
'73, there was a change in the whole attitude of the people that surrounded the club. There was an excitement about new people coming in, coming from other clubs, who had experienced some degree of success. I'd already played in 3 grand finals. Wadey had played in them. And we had an experienced few players, and we got more as time went on. And that adds to the whole flavour, and there's an excitement about the place that started to grow. And it was a pretty good year. We've come from rock bottom to finishing in that, sixth, halfway.
I'll never forget the first game. We played Hawthorn at the old Arden Street Oval, and it was just, the crowd was fantastic, and we were playing against a fairly good side in those days, they were. And we beat them, our first game. I mean, everybody was just delirious.
You get used to losing. And then someone like Brass turns up who just doesn't accept that at all. And then, you've had to get used to winning. And we got, I think that was probably 73, all trying to remember back, that we actually started to win some games.
We were too easily and readily to accept defeat, which Brass would not accept. If you lost, you would cop it from Brass. You'd have to pay for it on the Sunday morning training. So all of a sudden, and then you'd win and you start to feel what it's like to win.
Davis, Dawson.
We won 11 and a half games. It was a draw. And whilst we beat every team that year, bar one, we also got beaten by every team, bar one, that we played. So we finished sixth. It was then a final five.
We missed by a game and a half, and we had to win the last three games, but we fell short. We beat the third and fourth sides, but the top two sides were far superior.
We were beaten by St Kilda in the last game down at Moorabbin. We had won that. We were in the finals. Admittedly, we weren't quite ready that year, but the year we had with Barassi and those blokes just made us realise that we are competitive.
North Melbourne buying spree again dominated headlines as the 1974 season approached. From Woodville in South Australia, they secured a high flyer named Malcolm Blight. He'd won the McGarry Medal in 1972, but was destined to reach even greater heights.
The next year, I think we got a couple more players. You know, Barry Cable came back. He sensed that, you know, North was... He had already played at North, but he came back from the West. He at his best, he was a star. He was a great player. Even at the stage I'm talking about now, 73 to 75, he was still a really good player. Very, very professional. Used to do his own weights at home. And I remember going to his place for dinner one night, and 9 o'clock, freezing cold, middle of winter, drizzling rain. He said after tea, he said, "What about we go out and have a kick in the park?" I looked at him, said, "You're kidding." "No." He said, "No, let's go. So we did. We found a street light in the park and we had a kick. And that's what he was like.
Ron Barassi wasn't born with a silver spoon in his mouth, but he was lucky enough to be born with determination. And round here at Preston, where he grew up, he had to use it. He was an only child. His father was killed during the war when he was only about 4 years old, and his mother had to work. He became a legatee, but even so, there still wasn't enough money in the family for him to get much the easy way. When he was 17, his football career started in earnest, and his mother remarried and went to Tasmania.
I think Barass, you know, he really did step in and show us the way. He took us to a new level of professionalism. No question about that. And particularly a bloke like myself who was full-time, he taught me an enormous amount about success and, you know, the values and the things that were critical to success.
In Ron's case, I loved the way he played. I loved the way Norm Smith coached. I even brought players down from Shepparton to watch them train. I just felt that he was probably more important as a player than any other player in the competition to his team, because they had a powerful team and he was just the dynamo in the whole thing. I could imagine him being such a great help to his particular coach.
Ron Barassi's mother is probably still his greatest fan. During the football season, she buys all the Victorian newspapers just for the clippings.
Not that I was easy with him, because I say I'm not like him, or he's not like me. But in my own heart, I know that he is a lot like me. As my husband says, I say, "I don't know where Ron gets this from." And my husband says, "Well, you know, if you have a row, you're not too easy."
He had this total support of Aylett, but he also respected Aylett as the president, and he knew what these guys were trying to achieve. So there was never any doubt about who the boss was, where we were going, you know, what was untouchable. And as Albert said, I mean, Davis and Wade and Rantel and Cable, you know, fitted into that beautifully. I mean, you can't talk about the influence of Davis and Wade and Rantel without not Cable, including Cable. Yeah. You know, Blighty, who became a great champion in the 70s, he was just a Greg or a Dench or a Schimmelbusch learning, but he learned in that era as well from those guys, you know.
He's a winner.
Yes. Yes, he certainly likes to be a winner, but above all that, he's so honest in the way he wants to be a winner that people and the people under him, the players who are under him, have just got to accept his arguments, because his arguments are so basic anyhow. You know, everything he does is just so basic, and he's so honest in doing these things. And the players, it didn't take them very long to realise that they were dealing with a real straight shooter.
Ron Barassi was a wonderful coach, and I have had a lot of occasions to be with many coaches. I've been under, you know, the great Checky Hughes. I played under in interstate football, Reg Hickey in interstate football. Coached against a lot of them myself, and I would rate Ron Barassi right up there.
Ron also had a broader vision of the game than I did. My vision was a bit myopic. I can only see next week and our team. Whereas Ron and Alan Jeans too could see the wider implications of what everyone was trying to do for the game.
From the first moment he walked into North and spoke to the players, you know, he just made the place tick. And when he walked into the room, his very presence, it was electric. And it was always electric. I mean, that's was the dynamism of the bloke, you know.
Ron had this vision or view that your best players had to be the example. So best players make mistakes or errors of judgment or whatever, you barrel them harder. And it wouldn't work today. When the young blokes today wouldn't cop the verbals that Ron and other coaches, or Norm Smith, those guys are legendary in the way that they berated their players. Norm Smith was probably the most brutal.
That's bloody one! Darryl, you are a... I'll tell you why. You've got the bloody football game beaten. You've come down here not concentrated.
For a kid like I was to have access to somebody like that to show you the ropes is what's required to get the job done. Just terrific. I was sort of naturally in awe of the guy. What he said went.
The ball goes out towards the Carlton small man. You stay back with your man. You could have got to the Carlton small man, but I know I'm going to protect myself. I don't want to break going bad, Darryl, but to me, it's probably the cost you're bloody not switched on properly. Now you get over and try and mind the bloody forward pocket, OK?
He's always big on the little things. All the small one percenters, as they call them nowadays, he was big on those back in the, probably in the 60s when he was at Carlton, but he was certainly big on them at North in the 70s. And that's just the way he approached them. I mean, he didn't leave any stone unturned in how he can make not only players better, but the team better, perform better. And all those little quotes he used to come up with, I don't know where he got them from, right down to the one, if it is to be, it's up to me, which is 9 two-letter words in a row. We used to make us say that to ourselves at times.
I think they should know, one, what he says, two, when he means what he says, which in my case is nearly 99% of the time. They shouldn't be scared.
Stephen, you go to centre-half back and you go to full-back. You weren't anywhere near that bloke. They're playing 4 yards from him and he's a good lead and it comes out from the bloody back line very well.
You certainly wouldn't look at him sideways if he was giving you a spray. It was basically what he said is, you know, what you did, and you certainly wouldn't be suggesting or thinking that you were going to try and do anything else, because he give, as I said, he give you an almighty spray. It was frightening.
He was very intense, very intense, and you had to watch him all the time. You know, it was, and he practiced perfect practice.
What you'd learnt though, as you got older, was that when, you know, the quarter time or three quarter time huddles, you just got there last, not first.
You've done the typical bloody thing. The ball's gone over. Oh, I couldn't come back near me. You could have run and intercepted that first goal, or second goal, what it was, and you probably don't even know what I'm talking about, do you? That's bloody right.
And the other thing, too, that I always think is that Barras had a great respect for the administration. He was the boss and he ran his side, but the playing today, the thing that I most notice in footy is that it all seems to be segmented. You know, you have a football department there and the marketing department. They're all little sections. But in that era, and certainly in John Kennedy's era in the 80s, they had the ability of the whole club being one unit.
Now, if you both think I'm stirred up, you're bloody right. You're bloody right. If you are bloody fierce in your desire to do it right, you do it. Now, that's not how the bloody forward line do well, and that bloody back line play. This is too big a match, and too much money at stake for your bloody be like that. That bloody forward line's playing tremendous. Kevin Bryant, fantastic.
Total respect and awe. He was Mr. Football, and yeah, he's one of those few people who could push me buttons, I suppose.
I never forget Brass. He dragged me on the ground. I blocked Big Ron Alexander at North one day, 78, and let Ray Hubbard take a mark. Anyway, I got a free kick against me, and they kicked a goal. Fitzroy, Ron Alexander kicked a goal and put him in front. I got dragged from the ground. Mick's gone on. He said I had to get on the phone. Brassy, just give it to me. And he said, fair dinkum, crackers. He said, you can bloody well rot on the bench as far as I'm concerned. He said, we're an amateur hour the way you blocked. And I thought, well, I'm only trying to help my teammate take a mark. And anyway, I was there, and Mick wasn't going that well. And Brass rings up and says, has he repented? And I said, tell him to get stuffed, I'm still here. Anyway, and Laurie Dwyer said, he's repented, Ron. And I turned around to Laurie, I said, you weak bastard. Anyway, I trotted on, and I'll never forget at half time, I'm laying down, and he's walking around talking to us, and he's got to me, and he's kicked me, come up to me, kicked me in the guts. He said, as for you, crackers. And I jumped up, and I said, you don't kick me. And he thought I was feeding him. And I started to laugh. He just shook his head and walked away. He said, I've had a gutful of you sometimes. Just walked off. You can have some fun with him every now and then.
Just brought you together here to tell you about Saturday as regards what you should do when perhaps what is, in your opinion, an incident occurs.
He gave you head a little bit to show a bit of flair as well, as long as you didn't break team rules. There's a couple of times there where Malcolm Blight kicked a goal on his left foot on the wrong side of the ground when he should have been team rules to centre it onto the top of the goal square. And he pulled Blighty out over that, of course, and then on Tuesday night at training he tried to make Blighty prove that his method was right.
Part of his ploy was that if you're in a pocket, you'd kick the ball to 10 metres out from the goal square in the middle. And all of us, if you're on the forward line, knew that that's where they were supposed to kick the ball. So you'd position or head for there. Blighty just put it straight through the middle. And he sort of, the rule, da-da-da-da-da. He said, right. He said, you're going to have 10 kicks. For every kick, goal you miss, you're going to do a lap. You've got 10 kicks. After 7 straight goals of Blighty got, Brad said, forget it. All right, all in. So, yeah. So it just proved that Blighty was a freak, yeah.
he was fairly tough, yeah. That particular day, and the only defence I've got, please, Judge, listen, was had a quick look to the goal square and there was no one there, so I actually kicked the left foot check side, which is a non-preferred side, but I actually kicked a lot on my left foot anyhow, and it went through the middle. And I know we were playing Melbourne that day. We were only 2 or 3 goals up, so it's an important goal. So I sort of started to run back to the centre. Oh, okay. Actually, you know what? Nearly every game I see now, someone kicks a goal and gets taken off or goes off. I was before my time. That's obviously what it was.
Malcolm Blight, it's a big kick. It's a mammoth kick.
It was not only me, there was Blighty Cable. Croswell used to get into us something shocking.
The broad perception out there is that we clashed, and we did clash, I guess, but it wasn't in with any degree of malice or venom. It was more the challenge that he would challenge and test you. And I guess in me he may have seen something in himself, that the way Norm Smith handled him. And I was a very easy whipping boy, not an easy whipping boy, but someone that I would imagine take a great deal of delight, because he knew that I could cop it first and foremost. He knew that I probably had the ability to respond. So in one regard, it was a great challenge. And in my particular view, I took it on board as a challenge.
He said to me that once that don't get carried away with your ability, because it came out of the eye of your old man's penis. And that was one thing that's, you know, that's one thing I didn't like, and there's a few other things he said.
Any players around, you can still remonstrate by voice and by demeanour, but don't go in and create this pack and don't rush from everywhere. Because I think we've all agreed on this, we've had our talks about it. We've got to do something to try and make football look a bit better. This is one thing we can do easily, so I'm expecting you to follow those things out.
You look back now at his coaching style, I suppose it was tough love. He had principles and fundamentals, and he drilled it into you, and he was very firm, Ron, but he got results. And at the end of the day, some of the things that Ron Barassi said, you know, the 73 and 74, the 2 years I played under him, still ring in my ear now. And I find myself in normal, everyday conversations, some of the things I thought, gee, that's Ron Barassi said that, you know, 35, 36 years ago.
One night, we believed he wasn't there, and John Dugdale and Slug were taking training, and so, yeah, we're out in the track at North and mucking around, and everybody's having a great time for Tuesday night, and we didn't know he was up in the stand. And he came down, absolutely blew the shit out of us, and you're a disgrace, you blokes, and all that, and yeah, it was quite funny.
He'd bawl you out in front of a player, and coming after the match, he probably wouldn't remember it because he was so fixated in what he was doing.
Sometimes you just, I mean, you're so frustrated that the only way you could get him off your back, you know, was to play well. Now, did he do that purposefully? I don't think so. I think it was just his mannerisms, you know. It was passed on by Norm Smith, who's a very aggressive coach.
And that's the great nuance about Ron Barassi, all the clashes and the confrontations at the level of belligerence. It wasn't from an animosity perspective. It was more the fact that he relished the challenge and he saw something unique and special in you. That's the way I like to take it on board anyway.
I'm tough in my demands because I think the game is tough. And I think if you're tough on them, they'll stand up to the tough mental pressure that comes on in a grand final. And this is what you're coaching for. You're coaching not for a... You're certainly coaching for the short term. That's in the game next week. But ultimately, you're aiming for a grand final, a premiership side. And they're... Often premierships are won, you know, just by pure desperation, nothing else.
Look, I got away with a lot of things, tough things, people would say unfair things or whatever, too tough or whatever. If I did get away with them, probably because the players knew that I wasn't being personal, they knew that anyone else who was saying what I said they'd done, they would cop it too. It wasn't just personal on them, if you know what I mean. If you don't know what I mean, well, I'm glad you were one of my players.
Owens tapping on. Peterson.
You know, when you think back in the late 60s, North were lucky to get a story in the paper. They used to televise footy, I think it was the last quarter in those times, and the bit on World of Sport. Well, North never featured much, but in 73 and 74 with Ron Barassi there, he lifted the profile of the club, and all they became very progressive and, you know, trendsetters of the competition.
We're a bit lucky too. Those three players, those 10-year players, they were all good people, you know, they're decent family guys, and I think they were all me. They were all married at the time. Some had children, and they were very good people, you know. Luckily, they were all very decent people to be looked up to by the younger players. And
it was a terrific time for the club, for Davis, Wade and Rantel. When they recruited them, they knew that they were getting a full forward to kick goals. Barry was going to be captain and sort of more a ruck rover role, a little bit different to the halfback play, I think he was at Essendon. And, of course, Mopsy was recruited because they referred to him as a stopper. You know, he was a very, very good defensive player. You could put him on. He wasn't all that tall, I suppose, and not all that big, but he was just great.
Wade, Rantel and Davis, outstanding contributions, and albeit a little differently. Rantel was just a superb player that we really, well, we don't underrate, but I think in the bigger picture, you know, you look at Wade and probably Davis, they're probably more significant, I guess, in terms of names. But Rantel's role was outstanding.
I really never saw John Rantel beaten that often. He could play on small blokes. He could play on blokes, you know, a foot taller than him and beat them. He could play on left footers. He was probably the only bloke I've still ever seen that Brass could say to him, you're playing on a left footer. They only ever turn one way. So you'd be in the right spot. You can tell that to most players and they'd never ever do it, but John Rantel did it every time. I never saw a left footer get a kick on John Rantel because they just kept running into him all the time.
At the end of the day, I think your sole aim was to get a game, and I think there are a lot of blokes in the same boat that I was who were trying as hard as they probably could, Every time a star came, it meant you were further down the rung. And so that's all you thought about, getting a game each week.
Brass took us all back to grassroots, you know, sort of started off basic, you know, football skills, learning, berating, not accepting defeat until we got, you know, up to the 74 grand final.
Tom Hafey was up early this morning running along the Mentone foreshore in Port Phillip Bay. He was there yesterday and the day before. In fact, he has been there every morning this winter.
When you're up against a person like Ron Barassi, because he's got such a big profile, I think that would make you even keener to do well. Like, I think every one of the coaches who were coaching the other league teams at that particular stage would have been anxious because Ron got so much publicity, and you felt that you may have been a little bit cheated of it in some way. And he was just such a big name, and publicity chased him, which it always does and always has. But he's been marvellous for the game, don't get me wrong. So I suppose there'd be times that you'd probably want to do a little bit better, or you'd probably be a bit keener at that particular time when you come up against their teams.
Can you make it two in a row?
I think we've got a great chance.
Why do you think that, Tom?
Well, our form over the year, and particularly this stage of the year, Bob, has been first class. We played North Melbourne, 2 weeks ago, and I thought we had quite a few of our better players down, and yet we still won quite convincingly.
It certainly became that way. We were expected to win. I still don't think personally that we were as good as Richmond. We were a pretty good side, and we were certainly going places, but Richmond still, they'd won in 73 as well, and they were still the yardstick, so to speak.
Barassi is already a football legend. If he doesn't take his side to their first premiership tomorrow, he still has an impressive record behind him. People close to him say Barassi's complete honesty with his players is why he is a champion coach. He draws enormous respect from his men. At times, it borders on adulation.
When we finally made the grand final, I suppose there's a little bit of belief there amongst the players that we perhaps weren't quite ready for it. Obviously, Brass didn't think that way, and he was very, very disappointed, as was, you know, the committee and the club, that we didn't manage to beat Richmond in that grand final. I think we were 19 points up halfway through the second quarter and travelling all right. And then Kevin Sheedy and a couple of other blokes pulled a few rabbits out of the hat and did some magic things and got Richmond back into the game, and once they got 3 or 4 goals in front, we could just never get back to it. But it was certainly experience, and it certainly made us hungry for what was going to happen the following year.
We weren't good enough on the day. It was always going to be tough, and at the end of the day, someone's got to lose. But I think the North Melbourne Football Club per se learnt a hell of a lot from those experiences, and they won the premiership the next year. And a lot of people subscribe to the theory that you've got to deal with some pain before you can enjoy that ultimate success.
Probably a good lesson all round, I think, looking back on it all. Obviously, we were very, very disappointed at losing the grand final. Ron Barassi got up at the after-match dinner that grand finalists have, and he laid down some rules and obligations for everyone.
Towards Burns, he's in trouble as Clayton comes through. Clayton is tackled. There is Kevin Morris with Burns, a siren goes, and the final scoreboard in the 74 grand final reads Richmond 18-20, 128, North Melbourne 13-9, 87.
The grand final, we disgraced ourselves. It wasn't until half time that our feet hit the ground. We just weren't prepared for just the atmosphere, and I think we're all floating on cloud nine, watching the crowd up until, you know, and all of a sudden we look at the scoreboard at half time and game's over.
The way it panned out was just terrible. Going back to the Southern Cross on the Saturday night after it, it was just the mood in the room, it was just shocking. And yeah, you've got to live with that for another 4 or 5 months to try and redeem yourself and do something to rectify what you've done. Now, whether you've played poorly or played well,